get this working. So it's my very pleasure. So we have two visitors this week. So Kyle Jamieson from Princeton University and the Kyoto Marriage from Stanford. And they have been doing collaborations together. So Kyle has been working in wireless for a long time. He was at UCL before, now he's at Princeton. And it's a Kyoto been working on some security problems. So I'll just let the talk start with all the delays.
Thanks. All right. Yeah, thanks. Thanks everyone for coming and putting up the delays, and thanks for listening. So I'll tell you about kind of two major strands of work in this talk, and I'll go over them pretty high level. So the first one is something that I started when I was at UCL, and there I was looking at using wireless and Wi-Fi as a tool for sensing people and objects inside the indoor environment. Localizing mobiles and localizing people as they walk around using Wi-Fi signals. So that was the ChaosNets ERC project, and then that kind of led into some work that I did recently at Princeton University that I'll tell you about first on it's called LAIA. It's called it's a work that is treating how to program the indoor wireless environment itself. Then the more recent work, the second thing I'll tell you about today, is looking at using quantum computation to speed up wireless networks. So I'll start with LAIA first. Okay, so you know, IoT, we have many, many home devices, and most of those home devices are wireless, and that results in a really crowded wireless spectrum. There's a lot of interference between devices in the wireless spectrum. On top of that, when wireless signals propagate indoors, they are really, really strong reflections with microwave transmissions. And so at times, these reflections can cancel out the wireless transmission, and they make wireless really unreliable, as you know. So the result is what we call wireless multipath fading. And it's very unpredictable in both time and space. So the observation of this work is that most of the wireless innovation so far has been at the endpoints themselves, the mobiles and the access points. So for example, there's been a lot of work on error control coding, where we're taking the original data and adding parity bits to improve the reliability of the original data. There's been work just summarizing the wireless kind of scene. There's been work on diversity using different links, different access points, for example, to make wireless more reliable. And mesh networks are examples of this. Google has a recent project or a product on mesh networks from home. And finally, we have MIMO networking using multiple antennas, multiple input, multiple output, another way of making wireless reliable. So the idea, the main idea of this project is to see how we can instead make the environment, the wireless environment itself, more conducive to radio communication. So the idea is to take these low-power, low-cost, embedded devices that many of you have heard about recently, and embed a whole large number of them into the walls of an indoor building. And then, using this kind of massive array of low-power, low-cost devices, program the wireless the radio environment itself to change the way that wireless interacts with the building itself. And so, if we are going to do this, that breaks down into roughly two steps. One is like actually building the substrate itself. So like, how do you design all those devices? And then the second step is actually making a big control algorithm to control the substrate and figure out, like, you know, you change one of these devices, what will that do to the overall endpoint, communication between the endpoints, right? So that's the kind of the two big steps. Okay, now I'll do one.
finish. Yeah.
All right. So once we've done this, what could the goals be? What could we hope to achieve? Right. So three things. One, we could look at individual links in isolation and try and remove the multipath fading that I talked about before. Second thing is, if you have two wireless conversations that are happening in close proximity to each other, they'll be interfering. And so maybe with this this big substrate, we could reduce the amount of interference between those conversations and make the whole thing more reliable. So the goal is to make it all more reliable, right? And then finally, the trend in wireless these days is to, at the access point or the base station, to put, it's called massive MIMO, put hundreds or tens or hundreds of antennas at the base station and serve many, many users all at once. And so, maybe we could do something interesting with a large antenna MIMO base stations. So I'm going to focus today on this project that it appears at the most recent NSDI conference, and it's called LAIA. And the goal was mostly to improve individual wireless links, so I'll focus on that today. So, so going into more detail about that.
Yes, yeah. How hard is it to put all those embedded walls?
Okay, so let me save that for after I show you the the prototype.
Okay.
And you'll see. All right. So this project was looking at using a purely passive element. So each one of these elements for this is two antennas, just a pass-through essentially, with one antenna receiving the signal, the other antenna relaying the signal on. And these two antennas are connected by a phase shifter. And what this phase shifter does is it takes the signal, when you think of the radio signal as a sine wave, and it just adds a phase shift, as you see here, to the signal that gets propagated on out the other end. So the idea is to stick one of these elements in a wall between two rooms. And we're calling this a transmissive element because it's modifying the signal that gets transmitted through the wall between two rooms, for example. Okay, so this is just kind of one point in the design space. So then we replicate that at a large scale, with many, many elements in a wall. And then we have our endpoints of communication, right? So at that point, we have the endpoints, and then we need to build something to control the LAIA array, and that's going to be some kind of lightweight edge server that sits here nearby, and is going to be wired up to each one of these elements. So I guess this is going to get your question on deployability. So it's going to be wired up to each of these elements, or controlling each of these elements wirelessly on a different radio channel. And it's going to be looking at this conversation and then trying to adapt the configuration of these elements accordingly. Okay, so how do we do that adaptation? So we have a channel between the access point and the mobile device. And you can think of that as the baseline channel that was there before we started making our changes to the environment. And so we can represent that environmental channel as a vector in this two-dimensional space. And for those of you who are not into wireless, all you need to know is basically the channel is a vector in this 2D space. And so we represent the environment channel. And then we want to know the effect of this LAIA element on the environmental channel. So let's just take one LAIA element for the time being. And so we would like a way of decomposing this environmental channel from the LAIA channel. Now, when the client probes and measures the channel between the mobile and the AP, all that gets to measure is the superposition of the environmental channel and the LAIA element, because the endpoints don't know about the existence of AI much at all, right? So they measure the superposition, and then we want to decompose. So what we do, and this is an algorithm that Juju Lee, one of my students at Princeton, came up with, and he came up with this two-probe algorithm. So his idea was to take the first probe as it is, and the second probe, the wireless channel between it and the AP, except we're going to switch the phase of the layer element by 180 degrees. Okay? And then client will measure that superposed channel. And so his kind of observation was you add those two probes up and the element channel itself cancels out. And so you're left with the environmental channel on its own. And then you negate the measurement, the second measurement, add them up again, and the environmental channel cancels out, and you're left with the layer element channel itself. Right? So essentially by making two channel measurements, you're able to decompose the channel that goes through the layer element with environmental path. So that's one element. And so what we want to think about is how do we do this across many different elements? Okay? In addition, we want to do this across many different antennas. If the client, as you know, many clients will have multiple antennas and many different frequencies. And so we kind of picture kind of looks like this. You have the same kind of situation I was talking about on the previous slide, except now it's per antenna and it's per frequency of communication, because Wi-Fi uses many, many frequencies of communication. Right? So you essentially have number of antennas times number of frequencies of this kind of vector addition operation that I told you about before. So what we do is we look at this picture in the aggregate and we compute the Shannon capacity of a communication link that has all these properties per antenna and per frequency. And then we kind of iteratively go maximizing using the two probe algorithm, first for the first element and then for the second element. Right? So when we treat the when we run the two-probe algorithm on the second element, we are treating the environment of the first element together as a combined entity. Right? So this is not a kind of a theoretically optimal maximization. It's essentially a kind of hill climbing where when we iterate and run this algorithm again and again, we are lining up the channels of the environment and each of the elements. So they're all kind of pointing in the same direction. And that is going to maximize our signal strength, because our signal strength is essentially the magnitude of this vector. So we're kind of hill climbing to a possibly suboptimal, but probably near optimal solution. And the reason it's probably a near optimal solution is each of these individual elements is, if you think about the relative powers of each of these individual elements, the environment itself is significantly more powerful, maybe 10 or 100 times more powerful than each individual element. But there are tens to hundreds of elements. So together, they add up to something that is substantial relative to the environment. If we align them all, we'll essentially be aligning them environment itself, which is the dominant individual contributor. Yes?
Does it take long for you to get to that?
Good question. A channel measurement is done every packet time. And so packet is about 1 millisecond. So, you know, in a second, 1,000 channel measurements. So, depending on, if you're driving by in a car, maybe not, but if you're at walking speed, which channels can be about the same at a good 30 milliseconds, so we can keep up, especially if you're stationary, we can keep up.
That's what I asked, it's like, if the channel is changing.
Right. So we have to keep up.
Yeah. The channel is changing, right? The CSI information, you need to have precise information, right? You want to walk it so up. So it's hard to perfect or precise CSI information.
Yeah, so the way we measure the rate at which the channel changes is with the coherence time. So when you're walking indoors, coherence time is about 30 milliseconds. Okay, so over 30 milliseconds, channels march at the same walking speed at that frequency. And so we have that model to adapt.
Yeah, a lot of multi-paths work, right?
Yeah. So that's a good segue to the evaluation. So more to Renato's point, so we built it. So we have an IoT house in Princeton, and we took two rooms in this IoT house, and we drilled 36 holes in the walls and put 36 elements up in these rooms. And we ran some experiments with quiet and the AP in each of those two rooms. So we're experiencing multipath in these experiments because we're in the real environment. In the paper we have moving experiments that kind of gets to your question about keeping up, your questions about keeping up. But these are stationary. Okay. And so in these experiments we're looking at a baseline of switch off everything, right? And we're looking at a distribution of what rates does the client get at various locations in each of these rooms. Okay, and we're looking at bits per second in hertz, how fast I'm looking at this distribution. So this is the baseline, and to the right is better. Okay, so we turn on the elements and we optimize the environment, and we get this gain, and then we said, what if we wanted to compare? What if we wanted to compare performance if you were running Google Home Mesh, right? That's a diversity scheme. Okay, so Google Home Mesh gives you an extra access point, right? And the client picks the better of the two access points to communicate with. So that's this orange curve here. And you see, indeed, it gives us a gain over baseline. But in this particular circumstance, we're getting a bigger gain than simply diversity. And the nice thing about LAIA is that its improvements are kind of synergistic with diversity in mesh networking. Right? So if we turn on both Google Home Mesh and LAIA, we get further improvements.
Another of the important questions. So if I have my apartment and I want to put these devices, so how can you tell me, where should I put them?
Everywhere.
Everywhere. So I can be all my walls and everything. Okay.
So get a person to drill holes in the wall. That's what we take.
What about the power consumption? Power consumption.
So there's no active amplification of the wireless signal. So the only power consumption is to control this phase shifter. And I'm not an electrical circuit designer, but I believe you can design phase shifters with zero current drain when they're not active on phase shifter. And so, pretty low. Okay, I'm gonna fast forward. Okay, so the second thing I'll tell you about in roughly 10
minutes.
Yeah, roughly 10 minutes is this new work that's coming out on speeding up wireless networks using quantum computers. And again, th- this led out of a line of work I started at University College London on speeding up large MIMO networks using different computational techniques, both in terms of the computation itself as well as, you know, looking at massively parallel computation to speed up these wireless networks. And so the next step is on a quantum computer. Okay, so I guess the high-level picture is that in many problems of wireless networking, computation itself is the bottleneck. Like we've learned how to build really fast wireless physical layers themselves, and we know the algorithms to be able to communicate at a very high rate. And the thing that's holding us back now is actually being able to run these algorithms at a very fast speed in time for the packets, the data itself, to be decoded. Okay? So we're looking at a shift from pure wireless protocol design to the best computational structures. Okay, so in particular, when we look at mobile networks, we have reasons to put the processing away from the base station itself in a more centralized location and connect the base stations to that centralized location, maybe a mini data center via optical fiber or micro or millimeter wave links, something very high bandwidth. This is called a centralized RAN, and the major cellular carriers are moving to this. And so the case that we're making is, in the medium term, 10 to 20 years, we think there's a pretty convincing case for using quantum computation in the data center itself. And so we started a collaboration with NASA Ames and D-Wave Corporation. So D-Wave makes one of the few currently available quantum computation devices, today. It's called the D-Wave 2000Q, and we're looking at what we can do there. So let me get a bit more specific about the types of problems that we can solve. So the first one we're looking at is multi-user MIMO detection. Okay, so this is something I kind of alluded to throughout the talk, but to be very specific, the scenario is that you have a number of mobiles and they're transmitting together to a number of antennas at the base station. This forms a MIMO system that you can represent with a matrix equation. Y, the received signal, H is the channel, and X is the data that's sent. Okay? And the way that this is solved currently, so once you solve this system for X, you decode the data that's sent, right? So the way that this is solved is using a linear detector. So you invert the channel matrix H, you multiply, left multiply, and then you solve for X. The problem is, when you do that, you're also left multiplying the noise, background noise. And if that channel matrix is poorly conditioned, you're amplifying the noise. And so, all this matrix multiplication and addition and so forth is very low complexity. But in the wrong circumstances, which happen quite frequently, especially when you're indoors, you get highly suboptimal throughput. So, the optimal way of doing this, of solving for X, is essentially a search. So what you do in this argument, you try all the combinations of data that could have been sent by the three mobiles. Right? So suppose each of the mobiles is sending a bit, you have two to three possibilities. Okay? And the problem is, this is exponential complexity, so you want to send data rapidly, so they're not just sending a bit, they're sending one of 64 possible symbols. And you want to support tens to hundreds of modals. So now we have 64 to the 10 to the 100, 10 over 100. Okay, so highly complex. And so previously we were looking at parallelizing this problem, but there are limits to how much you can parallelize this problem. And so now we're looking at casting this maximum likelihood problem as a problem that the D-Wave quantum computer solves. The other application is low-density power to check codes. So these are really nice because they allow wireless communication to achieve a rate that's close to theoretically optimal. And they're also found in Wi-Fi, digital satellite TV, 4G, mobile, 5G. And so the way these decoders work is they have some data that they've received, and they have some relationships between the data, and they pass messages back and forth between the data itself and those relationships, and they correct the incorrect bits. And when you try and implement that on a typical high-end FPGA, that's really computationally expensive and exhausts the resources. Okay, so I'm going to skip the details, but the high level is we have recast both of these problems to an optimization for that the quantum annealer machine solves. So the background here is there's two types of mainline quantum computers right now. Okay, there's the quantum annealer on the one hand that just solves the specific optimization problem only, and it's essentially an analog computer. Okay, so it is using an analog computation process that I won't go into today, but it's using that analog computation process to solve this optimization problem. The other kind of quantum machine is a true digital quantum computer, and that is only available today at much smaller scales. Like they're up to, I think, 50 or 100 qubits in these digital computers. Right? So today we have these analog quantum computers. And it turns out they work rather well. So we've essentially reduced both of those problems, the MIMO detection and the decoding problem, to the form that the analog quantum computer solves. And then we actually embed that problem into the physical hardware of the quantum computer. The challenge there is that essentially the bits, the qubits in the quantum computer don't have full connectivity, but the problem has full connectivity. There's a relationship between all the qubits. And so, first we reduce the problem, and we embed the problem into this this graph that represents the real hardware of the machine. So, I think I'll skip details and just kind of give you some ideas of where I'm going, you know, looking ahead. I'm really excited about taking this programming environment and making it active and looking at ways of amplifying the signal that each of these elements send to get even better performance. And we're thinking about, you know, can we do this on wearables? Because, you know, what you wear is always close to your mobile device, right? So that might be an ideal kind of substrate to work with. Then on the quantum computer end, we're looking at you know, real digital quantum computers and other hardware platforms. So, stop there, and thanks for listening, and any questions?
About the use of quantum computers for your application, what is the performance that a quantum computer needs? How many qubits, and so on?
Sure.
The capacity that you really need to solve the real problems that you want.
Yeah, okay, so the D-Wave system is up to 2,000 qubits, and with 2,000 qubits, we can represent, if the user sent one bit per user, we can represent, can solve a problem with 60 users. 60 users, 60 base station antennas. So this is kind of massive MIMO territory. If the users send 2 or 4 bits per antenna, that scales down proportionally. So 30 or 50 users.
Is it really interesting to use quantum computers with quantum qubits compared to classical computing? Is it really useful to use quantum computers?
I see. It is because classical computers just, so those problem sizes I mentioned are just beyond classical computers.
Okay, so you cannot do it?
You can't. No, not in a reasonable amount of time. Like theoretically, yes, you can, but it's an exponential search. So, yeah, things blow up quickly.
Could you say a few words on the reduction to speak up of the problem?
Yes. So what we do is, the spin glass, spin glass is taking a number of qubits, and those are solution variables, and you give to the spin glass problem relationships between the qubits. So you say, you know, if this qubit is positive, the other one should be negative. That's a relationship you give it. Or you say, if this qubit is positive, that one should be positive too. In addition, you also give absolute relationships to each qubit. So you say, I favor this qubit being positive. So then what we've done is we take the wireless channel itself and the signal that the base station receives, and that we map that into these relationships between the qubits that are input to the spin glass. And so the mapping is different depending on if the users are sending 1 bit or 2 bits or 4 bits per symbol. But we've reduced that problem to the same. And then we run that on the machine. So that's kind of a hand waving. For the LDPC, so that's work in progress. Maybe ask me a question.
The number of qubits is one of the metrics to evaluate the capacity. You have also the time you can maintain a quantum state.
Yes.
It's another important parameter. So when you say that, how do you compare, I didn't know about this machine, 2,000 qubits, but how do you compare this with what IBM is doing? Which less
correct.
Qubits, but yes. They claim more lifetime quantum state.
Right. So the IBM machine is a digital quantum machine. So it's giving you an exact answer. And it solves, it does general purpose computation. The annealer is an analog machine, and it uses the same physical qubits, but it uses them in an analog way instead of in a digital way. So you don't compare coherence time, because the fields that they apply, they're analog. They gradually slope down and slope up. So it's hard to compare. And it's really not clear in the long run which of those two types is going to win. And we are interested in experimenting on both, kind of looking at, because our wireless problem, it doesn't require an exact solution. Because you can tolerate a bit error rate that's greater than zero if you have error control coding above what you're doing. And so that kind of meshes well with an analog system that also generates, has inherent noise in the background. So running them head to head is a